Hi, I'm Jenny Brocky. Tonight on Insight, saving money and helping patients. Can the health system do both?
The whole culture of medicine is slow to share information, slow to recognise we don't know it all.
But I have very clear memories of hiding in the toilet with my son's file because they didn't like to give it to you and they didn't like you to look at it.
And how much is that costing the system then? Welcome everyone, good to have you with us tonight. Carly, your seven-year-old son Lachlan has cerebral palsy. How many health professionals would Lachlan see in a year, say?
I think currently we see about 8 or 9 different departments at the Children's Hospital in Melbourne. Mostly doctors, sometimes physios or occupational therapists, occasionally a speech therapist, but generally doctors at the Children's Hospital. We don't see our GP all that often except for referrals. We also see our private paediatrician, just so that we can have a bit of an overarching view of where we're going with Lachlan. Mm-hmm. A lot of the paediatricians and doctors at the hospital, although very good, work in one modality.
So how much do all of these people talk to one another about Lachlan?
Very little. It is getting better, but very little. I'm usually the common thread in terms of making sure that we have a plan that takes into account all of the things that's happening with him health-wise and physically.
Isn't there a central record of everything that's happening in the hospital with Lachlan?
They do have a central record. However, I believe there are still some departments that hold individual records. And often when you see doctors, they look at those areas that look to be relevant to them rather than whatever else might be happening in his life medically at that point in time.
Catherine, you're nodding your head here. Your two-year-old son, James, has cystic fibrosis. Similar story to in terms of your interactions with the health professionals that he deals with?
Ours is more within the hospital system. James will see dietitians, physiotherapists, paediatricians, but often with his care, I find that the communication is not there. I find that his paediatrician will make a discussion with us that when he goes into hospital, we will look at this, this, this and this, but then when we're actually in, none of that happens. And things that I find are constantly missed, and as a parent, we have to be on top of his care constantly. So it's then my responsibility to be his advocate, ring up, follow up.
So you've got to keep your eye on everything all the time.
Absolutely.
And how often are you telling health professionals what other people have already told you and said?
Constantly. But I don't always feel it's heard either. Sometimes they're disinterested in hearing that this has happened in that point and this has happened in that department. Would you?
Absolutely.
Mm. Yeah. So how well did the two of you feel they communicate with one another, all these people?
Not well.
Very little most of the time. Mm. If we push for interaction, for example, Lachlan needs a general anaesthetic for lots of procedures that we would normally just go to our GP or a local practitioner for because of his movement issues. And we had to go in for some surgery on his leg muscles to release them, and he needed a general anaesthetic for that. So we actually pushed to have the dental team at one point come in and do a mould of his mouth while he was asleep so that we could do some plates and some work that we were doing with them.
So you wanted everything done at the same time rather than him having 2 general anaesthetics or whatever?
Yes.
And I've asked for similar, he was having a CT scan, so I asked for a bronchoscopy. Because I thought the same. If he's going to be under anaesthetic, well, let's look at what else needs to be done. Mm.
The interesting thing about these stories is you're the ones taking the ownership and doing the monitoring all the time of what's going on rather than the doctors talking to one another or the other people involved in the cases talking to one another, yeah? John Dwyer, what does it tell us about the way the health system works at the moment?
Well, when you hear these stories, and they're obviously common stories, we know that a child with a complex condition is going to have to need the skills of a number of specialists. But there has to be a captain of the team, and ideally that should be the general practitioner who is orchestrating all this for you.
But in
complex cases like this, often we set up in the hospital, we set up a casework manager who is there to help you tie together all of these things. Someone that works with mum, works with dad, that knows everything about the patient.
But it's not happening for a lot of people.
Well, look, we hear all the time, and it's true, and that we do not have a patient-focused healthcare system. Mm. You could argue that it's more provider-focused than it is patient-focused.
And why do you think that is? I mean, why do you think health professionals haven't just taken it on themselves to talk to one another?
It's somewhat historical, but in Australia, our health professionals tend to work in silos rather than working together in teams. It's the system isn't ideally focused with the patient right at the centre of everything. We know how to change it, but we need to change it.
All right, we'll talk about how to change it a bit later. Ranjana, what do you think? I mean, you're an oncologist. Is it fair to say that health professionals don't talk to one another enough about individual patients? They don't work together enough?
Look, I think, you know, Jenny, patient-centred care is the buzzword in modern medicine at the moment. But I think we do fall short of ideal patient-centred care.
What's stopping it from happening?
I think there are a number of factors. I think that modern medicine is very busy, it's very pressured. Also, care is very fragmented and people have various commitments. So they work in the private sector, they work in the public hospital. So sometimes it is simply the fact that they're not physically present to have these contacts with other doctors.
Okay, what do other health professionals here think? Why do you think we have these stories? Terry?
Patient-centred care is the patient having their own record. And these people here should have their own record. And to that, each encounter, the data and information is entered to that and they take it around the system with them.
And why don't they?
Because the system doesn't allow them to.
And why doesn't the system allow them
to? It's predominantly paper-based, isolation specialist-based, time restrained. Mm. Therefore, these are the factors why the patients and their families need to own the record.
As Saxon Smith, you're from the Australian Medical Association. You're also a dermatologist.
Yep.
How would you feel about patients having control of their records? Why shouldn't they have control of all their medical records?
We have no reason why they shouldn't, ultimately. We know you look around the rest of the world, there are great models of electronic medical records that travel with the patient. We often look to Scandinavia, where the systems they have for a patient medical record, they come out with a unique identifier when they're born and it follows them for the whole of their life. It's accessible for every health practitioner, whether it's in a hospital setting or in a community setting, and you're able to improve that conversation because it's a unique thing to that patient, but also it's a computer system that goes across those boundaries.
Okay,
in Australia,
but let's just get back to what we have now.
Well, that's right. In Australia, it doesn't work.
Yeah, I know we've got a system and we'll talk about that in a minute too, but I just want to get down to the really basic thing of just picking up a phone and saying to another doctor, I've got this patient here, you've got the x-rays, can I have them? You know, things like that. I mean, how often is that happening?
I do that every day.
Come in as a GP. There's no doubt we do it. I think one of the problems is the fragmentation of the communication systems. I'm constantly battling about how to get results across barriers. So, for instance, if we're just talking about the x-ray, I've got a patient in front of me, I've had them had an x-ray done, they've got a fracture. I want to bypass the A&E department. I want to go straight to the orthopaedic surgeon. So you do the phone calls, find the orthopaedic surgeon in the surgery, goes, yes, well, I want to see the x-ray. The x-ray was done in a private facility. He can access an x-ray from a public facility in the operating theatre, not one from a private facility because they don't have the mechanism to send it across. How stupid is that? GPs are actually pretty damn good at having electronic records. I get everything is in my file electronically. But I cannot generate a referral electronically because none of the specialists that I refer to actually can receive it. Some of them can send stuff back to me, but the ones that can send back put their hands up in horror when you say, I'd like to refer to you electronically. It's like, oh, no, don't do that. That's scary.
Okay, what does all this mean for patient welfare?
frustration.
Well,
what? Sorry,
frustration.
Yeah, Terry.
We're just establishing the whole reason why these people need to own their record. They take it across the system. What are we trying to do?
But what's in the way of that happening?
Lucy and Lee put it beautifully. The whole culture of medicine is against the patient having the record. Mm. It's slow to change. It's predominantly, as a physician, able to say about my colleagues that it is a culture of the profession.
And what is that culture?
It is slow to share information, slow to believe that we are imperfect in our communication, slow to recognise we don't know it all, slow to acknowledge that the tools we have, which are still predominantly paper-based, are totally inadequate and creating more errors and poor quality outcome.
Okay.
In primary healthcare, one of the big barriers from my perspective has not been the willingness or the desire to share. It's been these bureaucratic red tape. It's like I work across a geographical area that is administered. They have one system and then just right next door they have another system and they can't talk to each other.
Okay, but do you think the point that Terry's making about the culture in some areas of medicine being slow to change, reluctant to give up information, do you think that's a fair point?
I think there's a generational shift.
Saxon, do you think it's a fair point?
I think there's a generational shift. And part of that's, and please don't take offence to this, in the sense that the younger generation are trained slightly differently in that you'll go to a medical school, often you'll have an interview-based entrance exam. The style of teaching has moved from a very didactic style to problem-based learning and interacting with everyone and recognising the fact that you don't know that conversation and centering patient more into the centrepiece of what it should be about them.
Carly, why were you shaking your head then?
I don't disagree that there are some doctors that are making that shift, but I have very clear memories before the Children's Hospital went paperless of hiding in the toilet with my son's file because they didn't like to give it to you and they didn't like you to look at it.
I think that the other elephant in the room, and many meetings that I've been to about our frustration over the last 10 years of the slowness to introduce an electronic health record, this is so frustrating because this isn't modern Australia, but just 4% of people surveyed who said they were worried about privacy has had our politicians in stitches about this whole thing, and that has definitely held back the development of a patient-controlled electronic health record.
Okay, Nick, you're a GP as well. I just wonder what you think about
it. I agree absolutely that there are significant administrative blocks. I've had great trouble getting hold of important x-rays from public hospitals because in order to do so, my patients have had to sign a disclaimer and a waiver and a request that we then have to fax in and eventually...
Fax.
And eventually the report will come back. And that's very frustrating. And another...
I'm sorry. That's just bizarre.
Every doctor has to have a fax machine. And, of course, that's so much more confidential than than anything else because there's all the office staff standing around and anybody could be standing there and grabbing that very highly confidential document off the fax machine.
My biggest frustration was when we were trying to get registered for the electronic health record so that we could upload all this stuff so everybody could carry their own record. There was no electronic mechanism for doing it. You had to fill in forms with paper and pen and post them in for an electronic health record.
You're not serious.
Of course I'm serious.
And in 1996, this state legislated that faxing of any medical material is illegal.
Wow. OK.
Bit of a mountain. Administrative blocks that the medical profession have no control over. Mm. I'd like to see removed.
Okay. Candice, tell us your story because you've got rheumatoid arthritis. You've had it for 16 years.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yes.
What's your experience of the system with all the people that you have to see?
Well, I find that I have to really navigate it myself. So none of my health practitioners are in the same place. They're all over the place, really. And I find that I'm trying to interpret their information, remember it, keep a record of it, have a printed record, and then when I go to the next practitioner, recall it to them, accurately.
Is there any contact between them about what to do about your case?
Between the GP and specialist, there's contact. I'm not sure how frequent or... Yeah, but between all the other professionals, it's information that I've, they've printed for me, which is not every appointment I get things printed, results. I've sort of got a haphazard record that... I'm sort of trying to piece together and take it with me, or, you know.
So you're trying to put together your
myself,
own?
Myself, yes. Yeah. Mm.
Do you find that you're getting tests done more than once, or...?
Yeah, I did have an example. I'd been seeing a previous specialist, wasn't happy with their treatment. I'd finished off with them and had gone off medication completely. I was very unwell, I couldn't walk, was bedridden. I'd lost a lot of weight as well. And then I went to see, sometime after that, went to see a new specialist. And requested, I'd been calling already for my health record from the previous specialist, and that wasn't provided to me, so I'm not sure exactly why. I was trying to qualify for a new medication that has to be approved by the PBS, and I had to, some of the medications had to be, I had to fail three medications before I'd be eligible for the new one. I knew that I had at least two of them were not effective and had adverse side
effects. You'd already tried them.
I'd already tried them, failed them. There was a record of that. My other doctor had a record of that, but that wasn't being provided. So I had to try these other medications that, I knew that they had bad side effects.
So you had to try them again.
I had to try them again because I had to have evidence that they failed or weren't effective.
Mm. OK. What about testing? How often are people getting tested more than they need to be, like doubled up?
I can give you two examples. One in Launceston. Within a month of opening the acute medical unit, one corridor across from the emergency department, there are $1 million of unnecessary blood tests. In Canada in 2005, with 5% of chronic kidney disease patients, the unnecessary testing cost $4.44 million, but each test only cost $4.40 each. And for the whole of the Canadian economy, $1.27 billion of unnecessary blood tests costing $4.40 each.
So why is that happening? Again, is it
because
just a lack of communication?
We don't have the tools to correct our decision-making. Mm.
How much is it costing, do you think, Stephen, overall? I mean, you're a health economist. How much waste is there in the system as a result of all of this?
So there's certainly a lot, but the I would say there's probably 5% of the health system, at least, is probably this duplicate testing waste that's occurring.
5%, did you say?
Well, I don't want to go too high because, you know, then you say, well, you know...
But how much money would that represent, 5%?
$6 or $7 billion.
That's a lot of money. Yeah.
Jenny, can I speak to that as
well?
So with multiple testings, I think there are a couple of other factors. There is a lot of health illiteracy. In fact, it's rife. So I think partly duplication happens because when you don't have a unified system and the patient can't tell you what they have had and where they've had them, then sometimes you need to repeat those tests. The other thing is, I think, as we have discussed, when doctors work in silos, you kind of don't want to get into other people's way. And so one doctor does their set of tests and another doctor does their set of tests. And often the patient is left disempowered and out of this loop, and they just go along and have the test that's been requested.
And they don't want to argue with the doctor.
True.
Stephen's figure of $5 to $7 billion, I think, is probably on the conservative side. There are people who are talking about a figure as high as $20 billion a year of low value, low hanging fruit, not terribly useful things that people are doing. For example, the number of MRIs that are done for people with low back pain, the number of people who have arthroscopies in private hospitals every day, which are really going to provide no information. The number of vitamin D tests that we do has gone from a few thousand a year to hundreds of thousands a year.
2 million in
2012. Poor selection.
2 million.
2 million
vitamin D tests.
And it costs about 100.
Has there been a sort of burst of vitamin D deficiency? Or yes. What?
Well, too good with our sunscreen, Saxon. Too good with sunscreen.
No, it's more you design a test, people check it, it becomes a fad.
Oh, I don't know.
But are they necessary, those
No,
tests.
They're not necessary. No. 25%. Do you change what you're going to do? No. That's the craziness in the vitamin D.
And how much is that costing the system then?
$140 million for 2012.
OK. Let's just talk about e-health for a minute. Launched in 2012 by the previous government, in the current budget there's $140 million, which is going to be spent on e-health. How is the system working at the moment?
It's not.
Yep. It's not. Okay, who'd like to start that conversation?
I can certainly tell you that I'm tech savvy, so I've gone on and made sure my online e-health registry for our family is up to date. But when I opened James's e-health record, I expected that possibly it would have his x-ray scans, admissions, drugs, anything like that, the fact that he has cystic fibrosis. I thought that perhaps, you know, if there was a car accident, I've stupidly assumed that maybe people could go onto the computer and see this person has this condition or this concern, but there was nothing in there at all. So I've updated his like daily medication, but I've recently looked again and it's not updated at all, not once.
Do you use it, Carly? E-health?
No, look, we did look at it, but because we've periodically gathered history from the hospital and from our private specialists, I felt like I had access to all of the history that we needed at that point in time.
So you'd done all the work?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Okay, Candice, what about you? Do you use e-health?
I signed up for one and I also found it hard to use and didn't seem that effective.
Can we do a show of hands here? How many people have gone to the website and registered for e-health? One person in the front row. Anybody else? One person over here. No one else. Okay, why not?
What is it?
What is it?
Yes.
Good question. What is it? Would you like to tell us,
Jenny,
what it is?
The problem, well, I can say what it is from a GP's perspective. It's very, very frustrating, and that's the problem. What it is actually just a summary sheet of your medical diagnoses that have ever been made that are relevant. So all your key diagnoses, all your current medications, allergies and your immunisation status.
But who controls it? Like who?
Okay, so the GP is actually supposedly the gatekeeper. So you sign up for it, you then go to your GP and you and your GP tidy up your electronic health record. So again, you have to have a GP who's got a computer with a health record that's up to date with all your information. You then press a button on your My Little Computer, which then goes and finds the IHI, which is the individual health identifier, and uploads just a summary sheet, okay? It is then just a momentary snapshot of their medical history at that point in time.
As a parent of a child who's got complex issues and needs to see a lot of people, a snapshot for us can change in a heartbeat. Mm. So that level of information, that sort of summary is not particularly useful to us.
The summary is useful if it's constantly updated. And someone who's got a chronic illness who's seeing their GP regularly, I update their file, you know, they'll have been in hospital, I'll get the summary, I'll change the medications, I can then update the updated file. So that's useful because then when you next fall into hospital, there is an updated file there.
I keep coming back to this point. Let them cart it around. Let these lovely parents fill out the record, do all the... and transmit it to us, make it available to us. The research is showing that patients are actually better at this, doing this, than us.
Can I just say, it's actually very hard to always get the information. It's not always easy to get the information. So not all the information is on a discharge that goes to the GP, but like I find it, I'm always trying to collect and collate James's blood test results, x-rays, reports from the CT, and I've recently emailed and asked for copies of all the reports and I've had no response. So and it's very, and that's common.
I think your point there is that's the structure of the model is wrong. You should be able to do that and you should be able to get
access. Absolutely.
So we need to go back and know what we've been able to do, yeah.
And the GP should be able to get the results of those tests
by
not having the barriers to being able to access them. I can't access the test results.
Could I make a Luddite sort of comment here? Because it seems to me that the technology is making it too difficult for us. 50 years ago, I worked in Africa in paediatrics, and the mother would bring her child in, and she'd go down her bosom and she'd pull out a handful of paper. It was her patient held record. She held it, and I would write my notes on it and give it back to her, and she'd stuff it down her bosom again. When I was working in outpatients, when I'd seen a patient, I would write a letter. I used to use carbon paper. I would write a letter about what the consultation had been about, and I'd give it to the patient to take back to the GP, because... And we had a record, and we had a record. Now, there are some aspects of communication that are very sensible. We've now got telephones. We're no longer using faxes. We've got the electronic stuff. But it doesn't seem to be working. These people whom we've heard from are experts in the care of their children, of themselves, and they ought to have the record. Now, the thing is, we don't give them the respect that they deserve.
But why don't doctors
give them
that?
There is a problem with the culture.
Why won't doctors give it to them?
With the culture of medicine. Mm. That we are we've talked about silos and we're caught in our particular little specialties.
Anne, you're a nurse. What do you think about going into people's houses?
Nowadays, I'd be a little more reticent to go in by myself, and I know a lot of the community mental health nurses are a lot more reticent to go in.
Would it mean that you wouldn't want to do it?
No. Yes.
Ian Maddox, so you've worked in palliative care for a long time. Where would you like to be if you were terminally ill?
At home.
Why?
Because I think that's the best place to die. Over the last 25 years, I've done a lot of home visits and I've seen a lot of people die at home. And there's no doubt in my mind that that is, for most people, the best place for them to take their final breath, with the love of their family around them, with the sense of being in control of their own situation. And it works very well. Now, doctors have almost stopped doing home visiting in many parts of Australia. And we've got nurse practitioners who are coming up as people who could do this perhaps just as well very often and more ready to go into the homes, but they're not being paid enough to do that at the moment, so there's not a great deal of thrust for them to take up that particular role. But most people would like to have care close to where they are or in their own homes, and having to shunt around to specialists who very rarely know anything about what happens in a home.
Why do you think that doesn't happen more often?
Well, it's partly that culture that constrains us into our specialist view of the world. We tend very often to ignore the general practitioner a bit, send them the odd letter and so on, but you don't really communicate all that well with them sometimes.
Are there many people, do you think, who don't need to be in hospital, who could be cared for at home? What do you think?
Well, the biggest inefficiency in the entire health system is the fact that we have hundreds of thousands of admissions to hospital on an average of more than $5,000 an admission that could have been avoided if there'd been a community intervention in the 3 weeks before someone went to hospital. The University of Melbourne in 2012 finished a study where they said there were 7 million bed days in public hospitals occupied by people who wouldn't have needed that hospitalisation if they'd got the appropriate care in the community.
So why aren't they getting the appropriate care in that 3 weeks?
Because the infrastructure isn't there to look after them in the community.
Nick.
I just want to respond to that. I'm a GP. The majority of my work is with elderly patients and within residential aged care complexes. I do a fair amount of palliative work. One of the difficulties is that a lot of us don't do house calls because it's not funded. The payment for a GP to come out to see a patient in the home is less than the call out fee for a plumber. And you're not allowed to add travel time to that. But I'm very lucky where I work. I have a significant number of occupational therapists, physiotherapists, community nurses who I can call in to help keep people at home. I see one of the prime aspects of my job is keeping people out of hospital.
Absolutely.
They're nasty places for sick old people.
Can I just... Everyone's talking about the end of life and aged care, but we're... My child had 6 admissions last year, so it's not the end of life and it's not aged care. We're talking about young people as well. And we've used hospital in the home twice out of the 6 admissions. And, like, the academic evidence shows that...
What hospital in the home is.
Sorry, so hospital in the home means that generally when someone has cystic fibrosis and they need what's called a tune-up, it's basically IV antibiotics, usually 2 different antibiotics over a 14-day period. And so you would usually be in hospital for that entire time. However, on hospital in the home, they can actually come home after about 5 days and... they come home on IV antibiotics hooked up to them, and we had a nurse visit us once a day who administered one of the antibiotics and then changed the canister for the other antibiotic that ran for 24 hours into James. But
and what was that like compared to having him in the hospital?
Well, it was amazing because, first of all, we had our own food and he's able to go to the beach, he can have a bath, we can be in our own routine, our own beds. We don't
so far to, preferable for you.
Yeah, the IVs don't get done at 11 o'clock at night, which is the time one of them gets administered in hospital. But
So does it cost less, Stephen, to do this?
Absolutely. Yeah.
But cost less to his health as well.
Yeah.
More important than financial, because the evidence shows that antibiotic resistant bacterial infections are often caught in a hospital setting. So the less time we're in hospital, the better.
Are there people here, though, who'd have reservations about being looked after at home with the support people rather than going to a hospital? Do any of the people...
I don't have personal reservations, and I also believe that hospital in the home is good, but I do look after elderly people in particular who feel more secure in a hospital environment, although the evidence points otherwise, as we have discussed.
Does the evidence point otherwise, that it's not a safe place to be?
Hospitals aren't.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, in the case of an elderly population, you are more at risk of confusion, falls, fractures, you name it. But it can be quite difficult to convince many people, because a lot of people feel that by placing them on hospital in the home, you are turning them out of the hospital.
Anne, you're a nurse. What do you think about the hospital in the home idea as a nurse?
I think it's got some extremely good merit. Like, you're at home, you're in your own surroundings, you've got your own telly, your mum and dad are there, like, for children or for the elderly. As far as hospital in the home for palliative care, it's wonderful.
And as a nurse yourself going out to do that, I mean, how do you feel about going into people's houses? And
like, when I did community nursing, oh God, 40 years ago, I had no concerns about going into anybody's house, never even thought. Nowadays, in certain areas, I'd be a little more reticent to go in by myself. And I know a lot of the community mental health nurses are a lot more reticent to go
so
in.
So you haven't got the infrastructure of the hospital around you as a safety net.
That safety net is not there.
Yeah. Would it mean that you wouldn't want to do it?
No. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So
yeah, I don't think I particularly, at my age, particularly want to put myself in that situation where I'm not sure where I'm going or that something could be on the other side of the door. I've done all the hard yards. I don't need to do that now.
Okay, Laura. I want to hear from the nurses and from people who would be in this situation too. Laura?
So I have quite limited experience of such placements. Most of my work has been in the hospital, in emergency, where we've got security guards on call anytime we want them. I have done a couple of days of placement with a community nurse, and certainly I felt very nervous as we got into the car and drove off into the great unknown that is the patient's household.
See, I think this is really important to talk about as part of this discussion, because it's all very well to say, oh, how lovely, you know, people are in their nice homes. Yeah. Those reservations are very real, and presumably other people would have them. How do you address that?
Well, for a start, it's an occupational health and safety issue. You shouldn't have people going by themselves into an unknown place to provide anything, be it nursing care or whatever. And the staff have to be protected, have to be in a safe work environment. And I think most community nursing services now have two people in the car for these services.
No, they
don't. The whole emphasis has got to move away from hospital in the home to care in the home. What we're talking about is setting up an infrastructure where people can have an intervention before they need the more dramatic hospital type
care, whether it's at home or in the hospital.
We should explain what we're talking about with this medical home model, because it's been mentioned a number of times. At the moment, the culture is we go to the doctor when we're feeling sick. The rest of the world there's plenty of evidence that when you switch the culture around so that you regard health professionals as people into whom you will enter a mutual contract to help you and your family stay well, a medical home is a practice that has a number of different professional skills available to people who enrol in the program.
Would doctors be prepared to go to people's houses rather than working in hospitals and working in their rooms?
It doesn't have to be doctors. If we've got nurse practitioner roles who are able to help there, we're doing quite well. We used to have small hospitals. Adelaide's lost all its small private hospitals, community hospitals, where people could have care for fairly simple things.
Okay. Yeah. You mentioned nurse practitioners. Let's talk about nurse practitioners. You're one of them, Chris. What exactly is a nurse practitioner?
Right. So a nurse practitioner is a registered nurse who has advanced clinical education and training in the assessment, diagnosis and management of client conditions which have traditionally been treated by medical professionals here
in
Australia.
What sort of things?
Well, for example, for my own practice, I treat anything from coughs and colds, sinus infections, etc., to things like diabetes, hypertension, high cholesterol, heart failure, etc.
You sound a bit like a GP.
And in fact, I've heard that before.
What qualitative, is the difference?
Yeah, the qualitative difference is, first of all, I tend to spend a great deal of time, a longer time, with my clients than a typical GP consult for the same condition. And that's because probably 50 to 75% of my consultation time is spent on assessing, diagnosing, and managing the actual condition that they're presenting with. But the other 25 to maybe even 50% of the time, you know, someplace between 25 and 50% of the time, I'm actually providing education about the illness. I'm trying to talk to them about, well, okay, you've come in with your complaint of high blood pressure and you're still smoking and you're very overweight. So let's talk about those conditions.
And how can you afford the time to do that?
Well, that's actually a very interesting question, because right now in Australia, nurse practitioners are struggling to actually...
Who pays you? How
well,
are you paid?
Depends. You know, the nurse practitioners can work in the public sector or the private sector. I happen to work in the private sector, and right now I recently did a report on the financial impact of hiring a nurse practitioner to work in collaboration with general practitioners in general practice, and it showed that it's extremely difficult to maintain financial viability because the reimbursement is not adequate, and so. You know,
so do you claim through Medicare?
I claim through Medicare,
Medicare,
correct.
Medicare, yeah. Yep. Okay. So what can't you do that a GP can do?
So what I can't do is, for example, if somebody comes in and I evaluate that there's probably a gland, a thyroid disorder, for example, there's a nodule on somebody's neck, and I perform some blood tests, those blood tests indicate that they have a problem with their thyroid, it's under-functioning, but I can't order the actual diagnostic test, which is used to help supplement the diagnosis.
Okay. Now, there are 1,100 nurse practitioners registered in Australia at the moment. What do doctors think of their increasing role? Ranjana, what do you think?
So, Jenny, I work as an oncologist. I work in the public health system where I work closely with a nurse practitioner. I think they're worth their weight in gold. I'll give you some examples. So before the time we had nurse practitioners, say a patient who's having some chemotherapy tablets comes out in a rash, their skin is peeling or they're getting intense nausea and vomiting, they might try to contact their oncologist, which is quite difficult in a public health system sometimes, or they would front up to the emergency department. Mm. Once you show up to the emergency department, it's extremely difficult to leave. So our patients carry the nurse practitioner's number. They will call the nurse practitioner who brings the patient in into her clinic, which she runs on her own, or she's able to offer high-quality, evidence-based phone support.
How much training do you do, by the way?
You have 3 years of your baccalaureate registered nursing program, and then you have to have a minimum of 5 years registered nursing experience. Then you need to get postgraduate qualifications, and then finally you can get into a master's degree nurse practitioner program, which in general lasts about 2 years, and then after.
So how many years all up?
About 10 years.
About 10 years. Okay.
So the nurse practitioner I work with has had 30 years of oncology nursing experience. She is far more valuable to many, many patients, I think, than a 10-minute consultation with their oncologist.
Yeah. Okay.
The other problem with nurse practitioners, however, is that a lot of them actually work in these transboundary models where they're actually helping assist with the translation between the hospital and the home and keeping people in their homes. Unfortunately, nurse practitioners here in Australia are only operating at about 40% efficiency because of national, state-based, and local institutional restrictions in their practice. So it's actually quite frustrating.
Okay, Saxon, what does the AMA think about nurse practitioners and them having an increasing independent role in healthcare?
Well, we're a strong advocate for practice nurses and have been. You may or may not be aware.
No, but that's different to nurse practitioners.
I'm being very appropriate with that language because if you may remember about 3 months ago, the government tried to cut some of the rebates around the ability to fund your practice nurse, which provides the role that Chris is talking about. And it's a very distinct entity.
But it's 10 years training is a bit of a different role, I think, isn't it?
Absolutely. I mean, the kind of care that I'm providing is not as the role of a practice nurse. I'm a nurse practitioner working in primary health care, and I work with practice nurses, and we work as a team.
But look, we've benefited.
No, but I want to go back. This is really important because these sort of things become, you know, issues around what we support and what we don't support. And I just want to clarify that with you, Saxon. Do you or do you not support the idea of nurse practitioners writing scripts, doing the kinds of things that doctors, that GPs would do?
The AMA's position is that we do not support the role of an independent nurse practitioner. We support the role that they can have in that practice nurse setting, where they can have extended role, they can provide all the education that Chris is talking about, but as part of that team.
But why don't you support them having a more independent role? What's the basis of your objection to the idea of them having more of an independent role?
Well, the question is why are they existing? And they're existing because you have a model of healthcare, which means that an interaction for a GP is limited by time, because that's how you're funded.
But the main point is it's anti-integration, you see.
I just want a response from Chris and then I'll come to you.
I guess I feel that, you know, it's unfortunate that the idea of, first of all, a medical home is being perpetuated. I feel that it should be a primary healthcare home because it implies that people are actually working together in concert with each other. And that may be a general practitioner, that may be a nurse practitioner, that may be a physiotherapist or a dietitian.
With a $5 co-payment, that's going to push us back into hospital. If you give me that $5,000 from that hospital bed, I'll keep him healthy at home.
Terry Barnes, you've been listening to all of this, and I'm really keen to bring you in on this discussion because you've advised Tony Abbott on health when he was health minister. I think you raised the idea of a GP co-payment as one option or one thing to look at. Is that right?
I raised a model of a GP.
A model.
Which is a little different to what actually came out.
It's different to what came out. But from your point of view, how much more efficient could the system be without having to go to something like a co-payment to raise funds?
Well, I think when we look at the overall cost of the system and its sustainability over time, we have to be able to finance it. And, you know, and basically the whole principle of the co-payment comes down to the notion that if you have the means to contribute to the cost of your care, you should be reasonably expected to do so as long as it is a fair and modest contribution. Mm. I think what has really frustrated me, particularly in the last couple of months, is that the debate about the co-payment has absolutely swamped the type of conversation that we should be having about how the system should be working, how it should be financed, how people should get access
to it. But that's because it's been prioritised above having that
problem of the politics of the issue, Jenny. I think it...
Why is that? I mean, why aren't we hearing that dialogue?
Perhaps because it's a lot of the time it's experts talking to other experts about things that interest experts, and not enough is heard about things that interest patients as consumers and as users of the system.
I should point out we did invite the Health Minister and the Assistant Health Minister tonight, but no luck there, unfortunately. It would have been good to have them in the room, but keep going.
I think how the health system is paid for is a high priority, but it is more than just a single measure of the co-payment. The fact that our debate is reduced to that, I think, has been counterproductive to a good conversation. But it's also politicised it in a way that makes it very hard to make progress.
Given that we know that there are problems with financing the system and where the money's going to come from and, you know, rising health costs and so on, how much money could we actually save from some of the things that we've talked about tonight? I mean, Stephen, you're a health economist. Have you done numbers on where the savings lie?
We've done lots of numbers. I mean, we've done some work on hospital efficiency, for example, and we identified $1 billion worth of savings that we made on just making hospitals more efficient. $500 million on changing the staffing and using staff better in hospitals. So there is money to be saved.
The Health Minister in South Australia has just said he's going to shut the repatriation hospital. Now, I think if he saves all that money by all those beds and could put that money into community care, we would actually see something very useful happen. But who knows what he's going to do with the savings? We don't know.
The debate we should be having is not about a co-payment, which
the government's, it's not Terry's fault, but they have a health minister just looking at Medicare rather than the whole of system and realising that working with the states in our fractured system to put more money into Medicare, you would save a bucket of money by reducing hospitals' expenditure.
OK, yes. Terry.
And the NDIS.
Yep, sorry, over here. Yeah, Carly.
With a $5 co-payment or whatever co-payment they're talking about at the moment, that's going to push us back into hospital because of Lockie's condition. We're a prime candidate for being admitted when he doesn't need to be.
Same.
If you give me that $5,000 from that hospital bed, I'll keep him healthy at home. Because that $5,000 will pay for me to have respite, to be able to get a good night's sleep. It will pay for my mental health care plan. It will pay for my son to have the support he needs in terms of physio and occupational therapy and speech therapy so that he can become a bigger contributor in our community and participate more fully in our community. I just think it's absolutely ridiculous.
Well, I think we actually have to go beyond the co-payment. Again, I think this is part of the problem. We're focusing, obsessing about that. I think what we...
Well, we're not. We've spent the whole night talking about everything.
That's all the government's talking about, Terry. It doesn't, hasn't put forward one single idea for changing the infrastructure to improve the health...
OK, let him finish, yes.
But that's the point I actually wanted to make. I think that part of the problem we have is that the funding of healthcare runs decades behind the times. It really is a 1970s approach to how we look at the system. Basically, a system that is still designed by doctors for doctors.
Mm. Yeah. And, Saxon, your response to that?
It's not a system designed by doctors for doctors. But if we're just to the co-payment issue, it's not only the issue around forcing those with on the lower socioeconomic scale back or chronic diseases back into the hospital system. It was accompanied with a cut to the Medicare rebate affecting general practice and our ability to have this coordinated, you know, wellness-based model. So you can have your nurse practitioners, you can have your occupational therapists and your physiotherapists working in conjunction in that team model. It was slashing that.
Yeah,
so you're defunding Medicare.
But Terry's talking about wanting an increased role for people other than doctors.
Well, that's what we're talking about all night.
That's exactly the point.
But a coordinated, team-based.
Yes.
And we need to...
Patient-centric.
We've got to be careful that we don't fund a system that becomes more dislocated. And I think that's where Saxon is sort of saying where the AMA doesn't support, say, pharmacists doing primary health care and doesn't support practice nurses, because you then have this siloing continuously.
OK, but my question is, does the culture have to change for that to actually work? Does the culture...
Well, the culture can't change while we don't fund it. We've got no ability to do it. So at the moment, everybody continues to do their little silos.
Laura, what did you want to say? Laura?
I speak as a current medical student that this model is what we are being taught in university right now. My university holds online forums that cover cohorts of nursing students, physiotherapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists, and a medical student. And we can all come in there and take the typical role that we would take. So the medical student is the leader of the conversation, but it's about teaching us to actually understand each profession and what they bring. So it's not just thinking... It's not simple and it's not siloed.
OK. Terry, what do you think the political conversation should be about?
I think that's a very good point. And I think the political conversation should be looking at healthcare holistically, not just focusing on funding, not just focusing on who does what. And I think the medical demarcation, the idea of doctors as gatekeepers, as ultimate controllers, needs to be broken down a bit as well. Mm. But funding and policy has to actually encourage that to happen. Yes. And I think this is where I'm a bit frustrated by the co-payment debate, has hijacked all this goodwill that really needs to be there if we're going to make any progress.
I'm going to be very practical here and talk about tomorrow. If there was one thing that you could get them to do, you could get the politicians to do immediately, what would it be? Terry?
Get them to listen to those who've done it and made it successful.
Overseas.
Yeah, for the classic example is the project that I actually worked with. Think about 40 million people with AIDS. We have used an appropriate tool to control that epidemic within 10 years, as well as other diseases. How did we do it? We all collaborated, we got together, and it continues to evolve to meet the changing medical needs of the communities. And the patients with the e-devices manage their health.
Okay, Stephen, what would you do?
I think proceed incrementally. That is, don't try and do a big bang change that's going to fix the system overnight. We've got time to address problems. We need to experiment. We need to see what works, assess it in the Australian context.
Mm. Charlotte?
Take the co-payment off the table to actually allow the conversation to open up exactly as we've talked about, so that we can actually look at other health reform generally rather than it just being focused on this nonsense.
Saxon?
I agree. We need to take what's on the table and been offered off the table. We now can use this as an opportunity as a community, as all healthcare providers, to go, what is it that we want for our healthcare? What is our future direction? How can we make these models work? And it needs to be that collective conversation, not a political tool.
Carly, what would you want to change immediately?
The co-payment's obviously a great place to start, but if we're looking at it, a group that's going to start looking at what these changes need to be, it definitely needs to have parent, carer and individual representatives, not just doctors, so that we're actually at the centre of whatever these discussions are.
Mm. Catherine?
If it was immediately, I would say let's take the model that we've heard about, as I believe that would make everybody accountable, the doctors, the parents, the patient, straight away, that we could all see exactly what was happening. Mm. Yeah, at all the different levels.
Mm. Mm. Yes. An online health system, I think, is accessible to the patient primarily, that they can take wherever they want to go.
So being able to get your own information easily.
Yes.
Which was kind of where we started. thank you all very much for joining us tonight. Been fascinating, really worthwhile discussion. And that is all we have time for here, but let's keep talking on Twitter and Facebook.
Julia Gillard has won the ballot, 71 votes to 31. Kevin Rudd, 57 votes. Julia Gillard, 45 votes.
No's, 61. Yes, 39.
Holding on to the top job. Why do Australian leaders struggle with it?
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.